Thanks for joining us today. I'm Lori Johnson, here to bring you a special edition of CBN News Weekend. Well, you, the viewers, have spoken. Interest in one specific health topic we've covered is always very high, so we decided to bring you an entire show dedicated to the benefits of coconut oil. 5 million Americans currently have Alzheimer's disease, and that number is expected to greatly increase as baby boomers age. But one product may be helping. For some, coconut oil is slowing the progression of Alzheimer's. Take a look.
Steve Newport's Alzheimer's disease has slowed considerably. Some of his symptoms even reversed, thanks to an unlikely treatment prescribed by his wife, Dr. Mary Newport, a physician who runs a neonatology ward at a Tampa, Florida hospital. She became determined to help her husband after he failed the so-called Alzheimer's clock test.
He drew a few little circles and several numbers just in a very random pattern, didn't really look anything like a clock. And the doctor pulled me aside and she said, you know, he's actually on the verge of severe Alzheimer's at this point. He's beyond moderate. So that was very, very devastating news.
Dr. Newport began learning everything she could about her husband's disease.
It appears to be a type of diabetes of the brain. And it's a process that starts happening at least 10 or 20 years before you start having symptoms. And it's very similar to type 1 or type 2 diabetes in that you develop a problem with insulin.
In this case, insulin problems prevent brain cells from accepting glucose, their primary fuel. Without it, the cells eventually die. But there is an alternative fuel, ketones, which the cells easily accept. Ketones are metabolized in the liver after you eat medium-chain triglycerides, which are found in coconut oil. So Dr. Newport added coconut oil to Steve's diet. Just 2 weeks later, he took the clock test again and, as you can see, demonstrated stunning improvement.
I thought at the time, was it just good luck? Was it a lot of prayer? Was it the coconut oil? And I thought, well, we're going to keep the coconut oil going.
Then 3 weeks later, he took the clock test a third time and continued to get better. And it wasn't just intellectually. He also improved emotionally and physically.
He was not able to run. He was able to run again. He couldn't read for about a year and a half. But after somewhere around 2 or 3 months, he was able to read. Instead of being very sluggish, not talking very much in the morning, he would come out, you know, with energy and talkative and joking, and he could find his water and his utensils.
Dr. Newport documented Steve's success in a book called Alzheimer's Disease, What If There Was a Cure? She received this stack of thank you letters from other people whose loved ones' Alzheimer's was helped after they followed Steve's diet. And while coconut oil is encouraging, there's actually something much more powerful. A team of biochemists led by Professor Kieran Clark at England's Oxford University have developed a ketone ester that packs a punch 10 times greater than coconut oil.
It reaches quite considerably higher levels, and you can get whatever levels you want depending on how much you drink.
The problem is they need millions of dollars to mass produce it.
Very expensive. And so we can't make very much of it ourselves. And what we would like is funding so that we could actually scale up and make it. But of course, there's no real profit in manufacturing stuff like that.
So until a high-potency ketone ester is available to the general public, coconut oil is still a good ketone source. Just make sure it's pure, non-hydrogenated. Avoid any hydrogenated oil, which is the same thing as dangerous trans fat.
Many people avoid coconut oil because they think it's bad for them, but it's actually very healthy.
Dr. Beverly Teeter is a researcher at the University of Maryland who specializes in dietary fats. She says years ago, coconut oil was criticized for raising cholesterol. But scientists have since learned there are two kinds of cholesterol, LDL, the bad kind, and HDL, which is very good for you and is the kind coconut oil raises.
So they put out the message that it increased serum cholesterol, but the truth of the matter was it was helping the profile of the serum cholesterol. That never has been corrected in the public press, and I think that's the reason people have misconceptions about it.
So not only does coconut oil improve your cholesterol levels, Dr. Teeter says the way it helps the brains of some Alzheimer's patients can be extended to people with Parkinson's disease, ALS, epilepsy, dementia, even schizophrenia and autism. And one more thing, coconut oil is a natural antibiotic that also helps kill viruses like HIV and herpes viruses.
But the coconut oil tends to keep the bacteria down so that if you're assaulted with a virus, your immune system can concentrate on the virus. It doesn't have to concentrate on 27 other bacteria that you may have been exposed to that day.
So consider coconut oil to improve your overall health and perhaps even go so far as to stave off life-threatening diseases.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and we put it in food a lot.
If you're someone who has never used coconut oil, stay with us throughout the show. I'll be giving tips on how you can get started and some of the best ways to use it. Well, it's a brutal wasting disease that slowly robs the victim of its life of its victims, ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease. Patients lose their ability to walk, talk, eat, and eventually their ability to breathe. But now there's hope for ALS victims through a new treatment that's gaining ground.
I know, you can do that easy.
Deanna Tadone was a beautiful bride and a recent law school graduate when her doctor told her she didn't have long to live.
And he said, you have ALS. And at that moment, I felt like I left my body.
Deanna's father, an orthopedic surgeon, was shocked by what little help was available.
We took her to all the various citadels that specialize in ALS. And to my chagrin, there was nothing that could be done for her.
Unable to accept defeat, Dr. Tadone devoted himself to developing a treatment to help his daughter.
I call myself the resident guinea pig.
Finally, one worked, meaning it significantly slowed the progression of Deanna's ALS. He calls it the Deanna Protocol. It consists of supplements like AKG.
So we put her on the AKG, and then we ran out of it. Within one day, her tremors became unbelievable. Okay. Put her back on it, got some more, put her back on it, the tremors subsided.
Dr. Tadone chronicled his daughter's success online.
Soon, dozens of other people with ALS tried the Deanna Protocol and experienced similar results. People like Anthony Tapazzi, the former president of the Mississippi Power Company.
6 months ago, I had a problem with excess saliva. I don't have that problem today. My voice is better than it was. It's not perfect, but it's better than it was. I couldn't drink water or take a pill without feeling like I was going to choke to death. Today I'm taking probably 30 pills a day. I don't even think about it. I could only eat soft food 6 months ago. I'm eating steak, ribs, anything I want today.
Of the people who tried the Deanna Protocol, 75% report it slowed the progression of their ALS and reduced symptoms such as twitching and difficulty walking. Interest in the Deanna Protocol led researchers at the University of South Florida to study its effects on mice with ALS.
It's important to recognize that the animal model that we use is very aggressive and is probably significantly more aggressive than the human form of ALS.
The mice on the Deanna protocol had improved neurological scores, increased motor function, and most importantly, survived longer than the mice who weren't.
I think it's pretty remarkable that, you know, there's hundreds of drugs and, you know, experimental compounds that are being screened with this animal model. And relative to what's out there, I think, you know, this is proven to be probably the most effective thing out there that's readily available to the general public and to ALS patients.
Results of the Deanna Protocol mouse study were published in two leading medical journals.
To me, it's a very important finding, and I think doctors, neurologists need to acknowledge the results of this study and the feedback from patients, and I think they should recommend it as a therapeutic option for their patients.
So while a cure for ALS appears to be a long way off, some patients are at least able to slow the progression of the disease with the Deanna Protocol.
If you're interested in learning more about the Deanna Protocol, Dr. Tadone has written a book about it called The Deanna Protocol, Hope for ALS. It's available for sale through Amazon and other booksellers. Up next, find out how you can help your health when we talk with one of the leading researchers in coconut oil therapy. Just before the break, we showed you some non-traditional therapies for neurodegenerative diseases that are working, at least for some people. Neurodegenerative diseases are ones that affect the brain, such as Alzheimer's and dementia, Parkinson's, and ALS. Joining us now is Dr. Dominic D'Agostino, an associate professor at the University of South Florida and a researcher who is at the forefront of some of these therapies. Thanks for joining us, Dr. D'Agostino. How does your latest research support the health benefits of coconut oil?
Okay, thanks for having me, Lori. The research that we're doing was actually inspired by Dr. Mary Newport and Mary's observation of Steve responding to coconut oil interested me because we look at ketone bodies as a way to enhance brain metabolism, and we know that ketone bodies can be generated by coconut oil or the fats that are found in coconut oil, and they function as an alternative energy substrate. And they also have unique properties like anti-inflammatory properties. And also some effects that we're looking at now include an increase in brain function and also an increase in blood flow.
Well, when you talk about these ketone bodies that are in coconut oil, and a lot of people wonder, are there any other foods that contain these ketone bodies?
Yeah, well, medium-chain triglycerides are derived from coconut oil, and these fatty acids are found in palm kernel oil, and they're an 8-carbon or a 10-carbon fatty acid. And when they're ingested, they produce ketone bodies through liver metabolism. So what we're interested in doing is actually harnessing the kind of the ketogenic potential of coconut oil by further developing, ketone supplements that are concentrated forms of coconut oil in the form of caprylic triglyceride, which is a fatty acid in coconut oil, and concentrating this and delivering it in a way that can, that when it's metabolized by the body, it elevates these ketone bodies to a level that has been shown to enhance brain energy metabolism and deliver beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate, which have been known to function as an alternative energy substrate that can more or less replace glucose as a primary source of energy for the brain. And this has an important function in neurodegenerative diseases because all neurodegenerative diseases are in some way associated with impaired glucose metabolism in the cell. So what ketone bodies do when they're elevated is that they restore a defect in metabolism, whether it be at the transporter level or the enzymatic level or the mitochondrial level. Okay. So it actually enhances mitochondrial ATP production, ATP being the currency of energy metabolism.
That's very exciting. What further research are you doing specifically on the DIANA protocol for ALS sufferers?
So with the DIANA protocol, we're working very closely with the foundation, winning the fight against neurological diseases. And as a member of the scientific advisory board, and there are several members, we are kind of we're looking at the DIANA protocol in a way to enhance and further augment its function. So we previously published a paper in PLOS One showing enhanced neurological score, improved motor function, and survival in an ALS mouse model that best represents the disease process. And we're also looking at the effects of the DIANA protocol in the way it enhances metabolic activity and mitochondrial function. The next step is to a proof of concept. We have an enzyme that we're looking at that when it's delivered, it can help break down glutamate. And we know that glutamate contributes to neurodegeneration. At this point in time, we're combining the two together, the DIANA protocol and the enzyme therapy.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for being with us, Dr. Stagostino, and best of luck to you with your research.
Thanks for having me, Lori.
They're helping patients regain confidence and strength. Find out what some doctors are doing to help slow the process of Alzheimer's when we come back. As we mentioned earlier, more than 5 million Americans struggle with the terrible disease known as Alzheimer's. Although there is no cure, doctors are finding new ways to help some people slow it down.
Alzheimer's patients undergo mind training here at Carrick Brain Center. For 2 weeks, they encounter exercises designed to reignite the brain's areas of memory and personality.
We've had patients that have resumed driving. We've had patients that are remembering their grandchildren for the first time in years.
For example, a patient focusing on a dot while moving their head can improve connectivity in parts of the brain that have deteriorated.
In this exercise, Alzheimer's patients experience different kinds of motion, which stimulates the vestibular area of the brain and reawakens memories.
After her Alzheimer's diagnosis, Rosalie Kriesel gave up baking, although she used to love it.
How's that? Good?
That's all right.
After spending time here, Rosalie regained enough confidence to make cookies and a cake.
That really helped to start with, you know. We could really see a change, and her personality was better. She was more bubbly, so she kind of got her personality back.
Jean Jones experienced terrible anxiety because she confused her nightmares with reality. That's gone now.
So it's made it wonderful, really. And that was really hard on me as a caregiver, trying to be understanding with that and explaining to her 15 to 20 times a day that that's not really what happened, that was just a dream that you had.
While these stories are encouraging, doctors want families to be realistic about the results.
And the thing I can say is they're not degenerating at the rate that the disease normally declines at, which I think is very, very important, because the biggest thing that we want to do is increase function enough to where they can interact with their family and then not lose that as fast. Because everybody wants that extra minute, that extra hour, that extra day, that extra month. And if we can give those things, then I feel like that we're restoring some humanity that they just didn't have before.
After patients leave the center, it's crucial they keep their minds working.
So whether that's doing things on our iPhone or whether that's doing crossword puzzles, you know, stimulating conversation, not necessarily just being in front of the television, watching the television, but actually talking about topics. You know, those are the things that are really going to help to really activate the brain.
The right diet can also play a key role in slowing down the progression of Alzheimer's.
Well, a good brain diet is usually pretty low in grains. So a lot of the processing and chemicals and other things that we use to allow us to take grains from the field into the supermarket and keep it alive, some of those things are just not, you know, very good for the brain.
In addition to grains, patients should steer clear of packaged foods containing trans fats. Research from the University of Oregon shows that people who consume trans fats, also called hydrogenated oils, perform worse on thinking and memory tests, plus had smaller brains.
We know that in Alzheimer's disease that the brain shrinks at an accelerated pace as the disease and pathology spreads to a certain part of the brain. But if you have a larger brain and more brain tissue, you might have a reserve to handle that pathology better.
Scientists discovered that people with the larger brains ate diets high in vitamins B, C, D, E, and fish oil.
In addition to mental stimulation and a healthy diet, Alzheimer's patients seem to benefit from a stable home life.
That means minimizing chaos, keeping household items in the same place, and sticking to routines.
You know, if you're adding a lot of new things into the environment, that can be a challenge for patients who are having memory issues.
While lifestyle changes don't cure Alzheimer's, they can slow down the progression of the disease, which means more precious time with loved ones.
If you are interested in incorporating coconut oil into your diet but aren't really sure how to go about doing it, Dr. Mary Newport, who was featured in the story at the top of the broadcast, just released a brand new book with recipes in it. The book is called The Coconut Oil and Low-Carb Solution for Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and Other Diseases. Many people just choose to simply eat coconut oil straight out of the jar with a spoon. As you can see, it has the consistency of butter. It melts at about the same temperature butter does, about 75 or 80 degrees. This has been sitting at my desk, and so it's about 75 degrees there next to my computer. Or if it's hard, you can melt it in the microwave and just take the coconut oil that way. About one tablespoon a day is a good place to start, but many people consume much more than that. It's great for cooking and frying and sauteing, and some Indian and Filipino cultures cook with it morning, noon, and night. Coconut oil is very popular as a beauty product as well. You can put it right on your skin or in your bath water. Well, thanks for joining us for CBN News Weekend. We hope you have a great one, and we'll see you next time.